time, as they were popularized in France, and as they became part of France's national myth and Napoleon's legends in the 19th century. Every country, of course, makes what it can wars. We'll have the English Museum, the Army Museum, you will find lots of pictures, pictures. What tends to be lacking, except where the feat can be constructed into something glorious, something that contributes to the strength of the nation. And what I'd like to suggest is a French memory of 1812, but it cannot be part of the great memory in quite the same way as it could in Russia, even the Peninsular War could in Spain. Nonetheless, it becomes integrated into the Napoleonic myth and becomes an important part of it. Now, of course, the French recognize that 1812 was a tragedy. It was a tragedy of huge proportions. It was a defeat from which Napoleon never really recovered. And yet, inside that tragedy, the scale of the disaster was such, the scale of the ambition behind it was such, but it could be presented as a great moment of French nationality. The dream, the goal, and also the style, I'm thinking particularly of the Beresina, the campaign, were things that were used in order to construct part of the image of Napoleon Bonaparte, especially by Mrs. Sanders and those who remained loyal to the Bonapartist cause in the 19th century. Now, Napoleon, I don't think, ever had a low opinion of his opponents. The Russian army assembled against him was a great army. But clearly, Napoleon did think he did preach a message, but it was an imperial army to his own. Like many Frenchmen of his day, he was prone to stereotype other nations and other peoples, and in particular to regard Eastern Europeans as relatively uncivilized compared to the French. Russia, after all, was a country still at war with dualism. The soldiers were not free men, but serfs. Men slaved to their masters who made war because they were forced to fight. And the contrast between that image of the adversary and the image of the patriotic citizen still, in a sense, the son of the French Revolution who threw himself into the French cause, that contrast was one that Napoleon appealed to. Yet when, I think, as Napoleon returned from Moscow, he was beginning to think the unthinkable. How could he present the Russian campaign and his own role in it other than as one of the great military disasters of modern times? How could he turn it into Russia? Napoleon's capacity to write his own history, like I would have to say his beautiful self-delusion at times, is legendary. And some of his greatest victories to be produced by the pen rather than by the sword or the artillery. In his conversations in Zimbabwe with Paz, he emphasized the impeccable quality of his planning, the unpredictable circumstances that he found ranged against him, and a series of misfortunes that came. He was angered by charges that were made against him by contemporaries, criticisms of his command, of his abandonment of accepted military principles, the charge that he had allowed his army to be cut off from essential supplies, or that he had let his plan of communication be cut off the enemy. He insisted that he had left sufficient troops in reserve and adequate supplies to follow at Smolensk. His artillery, he said, were in good order, and until Moscow, the campaign had been going to plan. And he rejected any notion that when he had left Moscow, this represented a retreat. I quote, "The army's march after leaving Moscow should not be called a retreat, since that was a victorious army." More specifically, he went on to claim that the army, again, did not pull back towards Smolensk because it was defeated, but in order to win through Poland before advancing in the spring of St. Petersburg. And he insisted that if Moscow had not been torched, the Emperor Alexander would have been forced to sue for peace. At times, indeed, he went further, implying that he had not been defeated at all, that he had withdrawn strategically, and that further victories still lay ahead. конструкции, of course, the causing of the direction.
I think the direction adds a faint sparkle
of glory to the retreat, as the light of emerged from its positions about 9 in the evening, leaving a small beer garden on the left bank to survey the ending. This was to provide yet one more trick in the construction of the poem. I'm going to skip a little detail at this point, but the obvious point is that the poem is presenting himself to posterity, as he had done to the Greek terms like on Daphne, as he had done to the use of artists, to the use of perhaps other media, ever since the 1790s, and especially since the beginning of the empire. He was a man of peace, he said. I quote again, I hope for peace, but I am not afraid of war. In spite of the losses which have been inflicted on us by the rigor of the climate, we will control two resources. In the interior of harmony wanes, the nation has no desire to give up its glory and power. Now, all these are interesting claims. They're all pieces of highly coherent picture which Napoleon and his supporters are leaving us for posterity. And it becomes, in some ways, the grand narrative. Do I accept the Napoleon's version of events? Well, I accept it as a coherent narrative. I'm not saying I accept that things happened in that way, but it's the way in which they were reconstructed, the way in which they were presented, and the way in which the glory of the moment of defeat is preserved and becomes part of France's national identity. I think we have to recognize accepting Napoleon's version of events does to some extent diminish the power played by the Russian army. The quality of the generals, the resistance of the soldiers, and the hostages of the Cossacks in particular. Because Napoleon's version is very much defeated by the weather, by General Winter. Well, to a degree, of course, that is true. But you have to add that his planning, his logistics, helped that defeat he should have there faster. But if you say that he was defeated by General Winter, that is to eliminate the other element of defeat, which is the Russian army. And one has to say that the Russian army performed far better in this campaign than Napoleon and the French were prepared for in France. The Russians, as the young cavalry officer Gaspard Duke bears witness, fully understood the gravity of the crisis that the French faced, and they made every effort to prevent the French from finding the supplies. That's what they needed. Almost as soon as they began their retreat, Duke relates how units of Cossacks were deployed to snipe at the foragers as they tried vainly to find food for their horses on the farms and in the villages. The bad weather was already settling in, but the French were not yet in the grips of the Russian military. Their main enemy, as the Russian army well appreciated, was still hunger and the lassitude that hunger brought with it, and the Russian troops did their utmost. Now, the point I'd like to make this point is that French soldiers, French officers, in the letters they sent from Russia, and in particularly the memoirs which they constructed afterwards, letters have an immediacy. They talk about the circumstances you're experiencing. Memoirs you need to treat with a little more care because people have had time to make sense of the events, to construct a narrative. And the later they write them, of course, the more likely it is that they also read the grand narrative to the period, including the Memorial of Saint-Germain, published in 1823. In French soldiers' accounts, images of misery and the assassination of frozen corpses and dying horses do tend to dominate, and not just because these were the dominant images of the poems of the narrative. A shock is often evident in the poems. A shock made all the greater by the high levels of confidence which they took us into Russia in the first instance. As the young German conscript, all that mattered to most of the men on reaching that country was getting out of the hell of his poem, where they had suffered such hardships that several men, it was rumored, had shot themselves in desperation. But then he writes, on the 15th of June, the army went over the bridges into Russia. We now believe that once in Russia,
In the 6th of the letters he wrote home from the Moscow campaign, Hamilton would now explain just why the Cossack attacks were deemed so lethal. He admired the skills of soldiers and fully appreciated the nature of the threat they presented, and yet he retained a conspicuously Western reserve about their methods. I quote, "The Russians are singularly boastful about the supposed qualities of their Cossacks. It's true that they render great service to their army, but it is when the enemy is retreating that they are their most useful. At other times, they are not a unit to be feared. They may harass the enemy, but they never attack them with lines. What is certain, I believe, is that it is better to be the victim of their barbarism than to seek to imitate. Our soldiers may also have their moments of fury and rage, but they never murder those unfortunates whom they find wounded, and they do not shed blood in hospital beds, as the Cossacks have done in several different towns. It must be accepted, yet, that Cossack officers are not fully in charge of their soldiers, and we have even seen some who have been the victims of their own troops' brutal behavior." Now, I don't believe for a moment, by the way, that this is a reasonable image. The Cossacks were brutal, they did commit atrocities, but so, let's be fair, all armies at this time, including the French army. But in French eyes, there was more to the Cossacks than simply fanatical savagery. It was their tactics. Their way of making war. These were sufficiently effective and sufficiently idiosyncratic to inspire an extra fear and admiration in their victims. Henri Bourgeois, describing himself as an eyewitness to events in Russia and publishing his account of the campaign almost as soon as he got back to France, describes what it meant to be at the receiving end of a Cossack attack. He had been escorting the Emperor and his entourage when Cossack warriors had struck out at them, uttering martyrdom. They hurled themselves at our people with such impetuosity that they had no time to prepare themselves for battle. Not that the Cossacks were so difficult, although their methods were unusual and took the French by surprise. Not that the Russians were an army of heart. But simply that the French soldiers, in the memorials that they leave behind, in the letters they write, in the memoirs they pen, they helped to create an image of the war in Russia which we still believe today. And more importantly, it is an image which tends to reinforce the Gordon's own view of events. The soldiers also say that their great enemy was the cold. The soldiers also emphasize the cruelty, the barbarism, the exoticism of the Russian soldiers. They also mention the misfortune, the moments of bad luck, the moments possibly where the Gordon's judgment would have been better, but essentially they don't blame him, they blame circumstances. And it seems to me that the important thing to hold out of this is the way in which the soldiers and their officers who come back from Russia, the 10% who drag themselves miserably back after that appalling adventure, in their own rather heroic way, through their writings, contribute, it seems to me, directly to the Napoleonic legend and the version of events which will become part of the grand French narrative.